حسبت أن أصحاب الكهف والرقيم كانوا من آياتنا عجبا؟
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ثم بعثناهم لنعلم أي الحزبين أحصى لما لبثوا أمدا. صدق الله العظيم. So just to recap the note on which we concluded, the youth took shelter, refuge and amnesty in the cave, asking, beseeching, imploring the Almighty to make it easy for them and grant them accomplishment in their goal. And what was the intervention of the Almighty to enable and to assist and to empower these youth? فَضَرَبْنَا عَلَىٰ آذَانِهِمْ فِي الْكَهْفِ سِنِينَ عَدَدًا. Verse number 11, we then cast a veil of sleep over their ears, which was a reflection, and it denoted the depth of the sleep. It was just not a light sleep. It was just not a snooze. It was just not a power nap. It was a deep sleep for 3 centuries, for 3 centuries. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them peaceful sleep, and they couldn't hear anything. Nobody knew about their whereabouts. They were in deep sleep, and Allah kept them away from all the happenings around. And this is the beauty of the intervention of the Almighty. So at the time when Pharaoh had instructed for the killing of children, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلِتُصْنَعَ عَلَىٰ عَيْنِي وَأَلْقَيْتُ عَلَيْكَ مَحَبَّةً مِنِّي. And I had cast this beauty on you, O Musa. I had cast this beauty that as much as Pharaoh was a murderer of innocent children, but when you looked at Musa alayhi salam, he was just exceptionally beautiful, adorable, and irresistible. And as soon as there's beauty in the heart for someone, it just becomes a blockage to inflict any harm on that person. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them deep sleep. Then verse number 12, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ثُمَّ بَعَثْنَاهُمْ. Then we revived them. Then we revived them from that sleep of theirs. لِنَعْلَمَ أَيُّ الْحِزْبَيْنِ أَحْصَى لِمَا لَبِثُوا أَمَدًا. To see, meaning to reveal and to express. لِنَعْلَمْ أَيْ عِلْمَ ظُهُورٍ. To make it known to others, because Allah knows everything from the inception. Allah knows it. Allah has ilm azali, ilm qadim, as we would say in academic language. The knowledge of Allah is permanent, and Allah knows everything in advance of what will occur and what has occurred. يَعْلَمُ مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمَا خَلْفَهُمْ. Allah knows the past and the future. So wherever Allah says, لِنَعْلَمْ, so that we can discover, so that we realize, so that we know, أي علم ظهور, we make our knowledge known to others. ثم بعثناهم لنعلم أي الحزبين, which out of the 2 groups have recorded the duration of their sleep correctly. Which out of the 2 groups? Now what is meant by حزبون, meaning group, حزبين meaning dual, 2 groups? According to the opinion of Mujahid and others, which is captured in Tafsir Kabir, Fakhruddin Razi rahimahullah has made mention of it, that the 2 groups referred to 2 groups from within their ranks. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revived them, they withdrew from the group, the nation, the tyranny of the tyrant, whose name historically was Diqyanus, and they went into this cave, and we spoke about it geographically, etc. And they took refuge and amnesty, and then Allah gave them this deep sleep, pure wholesome sleep. And I urge you, my young brother, unfortunately today many youth have succumbed to the temptation of substance abuse, and then they pop these pills and take these recreational drugs to supposedly numb them and give them this long sleep and just swallow and drown all their misery. Look at the pure wholesome sleep that Allah gave these youth. They withdrew from the wrong and the vice and the idolatry and the polytheism and the disbelief that was happening in their community. They took shelter and refuge in the cave, and subhanallah, Allah gave them pure wholesome sleep. And that's not all. As we will develop further, you will see the divine interventions of the Almighty for the protection of these youth. So Allah then revived them, so that to see and make known to others which of the 2 groups will be more accurate in recording the duration. So when Allah revived them, and then they started speaking amongst themselves, hey, how long have we been sleeping? You know, if you are in deep sleep or you fell off to sleep at an airport awaiting a flight, or you know what, you have a halt over and you were just taking a quick nap and then you went into deep sleep, or you sit in your car and it's lunchtime, 1 to 2, and because you had a restless night or insomniac night, and then you, when you opened your eyes and you looked at your watch, lo and behold, you know what, everyone around you is gone and it's no more midday, it's the late evening, and then now you're just trying to gather yourself and find your balance, and then you were in a deep dream and there was this you know, different thoughts and emotions, and it almost takes you a few moments before you gather yourself. So when they kind of gathered themselves, and then they said, hey, how long have we been sleeping? So one said, labithna yawman aw ba'd yawm, labithna yawman aw ba'd yawm. I don't know, was it half a day or probably a day? Qalu rabbukum a'lamu bima labithtum. While the others responded and said, no, you know what, let's not discuss and debate how long we slept. Surely Allah knows how long we slept. And that's the reference given in the ayah, that while neither of the two could specify the absolute detail of the duration of the sleep, but the correct answer implied is those who handed it over to Allah, those who said, Rabbukum a'lamu bima labithtum, surely Allah knows how long you slept. And another point of reflection, my brother, my sister, my listener, my viewer, is at this point, Allah gave them such a long sleep, yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it appear to them that it was half a day or one day. This is amazing, that outside in the world, years are passing, centuries are turning, and for these youth within the cave, you know what, almost there's a halt to time, that after rising, after three centuries, they assuming it to be only a day, or half a day, or one day. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. In the third juz of the Quran, in Surah Baqarah, second chapter, verse 259, Allah speaks about the tale and the narrative of Uzair alayhi salam, as expounded by the scholars of tafsir. أو كالذي مر على قرية وهي خاوية على عروشها. Of course, أو كالذي, the عطف is on the verses that preceded it. Or like the person, مر, who passed, على قرية, a locality, وهي خاوية على عروشها, a ساقطة على عروشها, which had overturned on its rooftops. قال أن يحيي هذه الله بعد موتها. And Uzair عليه السلام just looks at the debris and looks at the ruin and looks at the rubble, and he's like, I'm just wondering in which manner. Of course, he has absolute conviction on the strength and the power and the grandeur and the magnanimity of Allah. In which manner will Allah revive all of this? Anna yuhyi hadhihi Allahu ba'da mawtiha fa amatahu Allahu mi'ata 'amin. A verse of the Quran, and that's our belief in aqeedah. With absolute conviction and yaqeen, Allah gives him death for a century. Allah gives him death for a century. And in Ruhul Bayan, it is mentioned, I read, أَعْمَى اللَّهُ أَبْصَارَ الْإِنْسِ وَالْجِنِّ وَالطُّيُورِ وَالسِّبَاعِ. Allah gave him death on that spot, and Allah then veiled him from the vision of humans and jinn and animals and predators and birds and vultures. So he collapsed at that point, and Allah gave him a sleep for a century, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala veiled everyone. You know, this is it. When we say the power, the qudra, the might, the grandeur of Allah, then it is just infinite. It is just infinite. Allah has absolute, total power over everything. أَعْمَى اللَّهُ أَبْصَارَ الْإِنْسِ وَالْجِنِّ وَالطُّيُورِ وَالسِّبَاعِ. And so, for one century he rests on his place, and his donkey also dies, which was his mode of transport. And after a century, ثُمَّ بَعَثَ, Allah revives him. And then he's asked, كَمْ لَبِثْتَ, how long did you sleep? قَالَ لَبِثْتُ يَوْمًا أَوْ بَعْضَ يَوْمٍ, I think probably a day or half a day. And many scholars say it's because he went to sleep in the morning, and when he got up, it was towards the evening. So he thought it was the evening of the same day. It was the evening of the same day. And then it was told to him, بَلْ لَبِثْتَ مِئَةَ عَامٍ بَلْ لَبِثْتَ مِئَةَ عَامٍ أَوْ عُزَيْرِ You've been resting for one century. وَانْظُرْ إِلَىٰ حِمَارِكَ وَلِنَجَعَلَكَ آيَةً لِلنَّاسِ And your sleeping and subsequent revival is a reflection of how resurrection will take place. And now look at your mule and donkey. وَانْظُرْ إِلَىٰ الْحِمَارِ كَيْفَ نُنْشِزُهَا ثُمَّ نَكْسُوهَا لَحْمًا How we will assemble the bones and then we will clad it with flesh. And that's precisely what happened. And he's seen how the bones came together and it was covered and cladded with flesh. And then Allah gave it life and he mounted back onto that conveyance. قَالَ أَعْلَمُ أَنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ I absolutely have yaqeen and conviction without an iota of doubt that Allah has power over everything. So Allah gave them the sleep is the one thing. But then the second thing is the notion for them to feel. And now I have a flash of another verse, Allahu Akbar. So in the 10th juz, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about Badr, the campaign of Badr. And Allah refers to it as Yawm al-Furqan, the day where truth and falsehood was separated. The Quran is referred to as Furqan as well. شَهْرُ رَمَضَانَ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِيهِ الْقُرْآنِ هُدًى لِلنَّاسِ وَبَيِّنَاتٍ مِّنَ الْهُدَى وَالْفُرْقَانِ Right? There are clear signs in the Quran and it separates truth from falsehood. So Allah referred to it, يَوْمَ الْفُرْقَانِ يَوْمَ الْتَقَى الْجَمْعَانِ The day of Furqan, when the two armies met. And then Allah said that remember that time, يُقَلِّلُكُمْ فِي أَعْيُنِهِمْ That وَإِذْ يُرِيكُمُوهُمْ إِذِ الْتَقَيْتُمْ فِي أَعْيُنِكُمْ قَلِيلًا وَيُقَلِّلُكُمْ My word. And remember the time when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reduced the image and the numbers of your opponent in your eyes. So in reality, Their numbers were more, more than double than the believers. And automatically when you're going to see your opponent is more than you, more well equipped, it's going to create a psychological weakness and feebleness in you. وَإِذْ يُرِيكُمُوهُمْ إِذِ الْتَقَيْتُمْ فِي أَعْيُنِكُمْ قَلِيلًا So Allah made the opponent appear less in the eyes of the companions. That's it. Their numbers remain the same. But in the eyes of the Sahaba, Allah made them appear less so that it can give strength and courage and confidence to the companions that no, they not much. They you know what, we will have courage and strength. The point I'm saying is the numbers can be large. Allah can reduce them in your eye. You can sleep for centuries. Allah can make you feel you only slept for a period of time. We move on. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then says in verse 13, نَحْنُ نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ نَبَأَهُمْ بِالْحَقِّ إِنَّهُمْ فِتْيَةٌ آمَنُوا بِرَبِّهِمْ وَزِدْنَاهُمْ هُدَى So in verse 9, there was a brief and ijmali introduction to the narrative. Have you heard about the people of the cave and Raqim, inscription, or the mountain, or the locality, etc.? Do you think that they were unique from our signs? Now in verse 13, Allah formally opens up the discussion about these youth. And what does Allah say? نَحْنُ نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ نَبَأَهُمْ بِالْحَقِّ نَحْنُ we. And of course, we ought to know this. Wherever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses the expression of plural, it is to denote authority, majesty, greatness, magnanimity. And it does not suggest dual or multiple. And this can be understood through Arabic poetry. So many places in the Arabic language where a plural expression denotes authority. A plural expression denotes authority. نَحْنُ we نَقُصُّ narrate to you, عَلَيْكَ upon you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, نَبَأَهُمْ their tale, their incident, their happenings, بِالْحَقِّ بالحق. What absolute truth? بالحق is to refute all the other things. Some would say this, some would say this here. Sometimes when there are, you know what, rumors circulating, or there's 10 different versions, then you get an eyewitness and he comes forward or she comes forward and he says, you know what, let me tell it to you from the horse's mouth. Min famil hisan, from the horse's mouth, one on one. I seen it with my naked eye. Well, nobody can give you more accurate details of anything other than as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives it to you, because of course Allah is the knower of everything. So naba'ahum, their story, their tale, bilhaqi, with absolute truth. What does Allah say? Verse 13, innahum fityatun amanu. Again, my respected young boy, my respected young girl, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala focuses and magnifies the point of youth. Innahum fitya, surely they were young. Someone said, four qualities are amazing if anybody possess it. But if four particular categories have it, it just enhances the beauty. Number one, al-adlu fi kulli insanin hasanun, lakin fil qudati ahsan. Justice is great, it's wonderful if I execute it, if you implement it. But there's nothing better than a just ruler. A ruler, a governor in power, in authority, and he executes justice, that's the best thing. Number two, as-sakhawatu min al-aghniya'i hasanun, lakin fil fuqara'i ahsan. Generosity is wonderful in the wealthy, but if a poor man, despite his meager income, if he can spend from that, then that is just amazing. Ma a'zamu as-sadaqa juhdul muqil. Ma a'zamu as-sadaqa juhdul muqil. What is the greatest form of charity? That meager donation of the person who's just having basic amount. He barely has anything. I have a flash of that incident when Hassan radiallahu anhu seen the slave Aban, and he was busy eating a slice of bread, and he was feeding the dog until it came to it, you know, that there was now just one slice left and everything else was depleted. Ila an shatarahu ila an shatara al kalba. So Hassan radiallahu anhu observed that this slave cut that slice of bread in half. It's a beggar eating, it's a poor humble man, cut that slice of bread in half, gave half to the dog and ate it. When Sayyidina Hassan radiallahu anhu seen this, tears welled up in his eyes. He said, ma hamalaka ala an shatarta al kalba. Ma hamalaka ala an shatarta al kalba. What made you give the dog half the slice and you ate half slice? I mean, you know what, you hungry, that's all you have. Why did you divide that slice of bread? He said, istahat aynaya min aynayhi an ughabinahu. I simply could not swallow that bread down my throat, knowing that there's a hungry animal next to me. And I ask myself a tough question here, my brother, and you can ask yourself that same question. I don't want to trample your feet. You can make the call in yourself. How many of us eat a meal, not only an animal or a creature, but humans around us? And I'm not trivializing the need of feeding animals. We need to feed every. Alana fil baha'imi ajrun. Alana fil baha'imi ajrun. Today we talk about animal welfare and animal rights. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam spoke about it 14 centuries ago. O Nabi of Allah, will we be rewarded if we show kindness to animals? And he said, feed any living creature. I'm paraphrasing. Feed any living creature and your reward is guaranteed. فَارْكَبُوهَا صَالِحَةً وَاتْرُكُوهَا صَالِحَةً. When you dismount, leave that animal in a good state. When you mount onto it, put that animal in good state. Don't abuse it, don't exploit it in any way. There are narrations in Bidayah wa Nihaya under the chapter of Mu'jizat, where certain animals came and complained to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam about any form of ill treatment that was done towards them. So Aban, the slave, said, I didn't have the courage to swallow that and seen a dog hungry. Of course, Hassan radiallahu anhu was Hassan radiallahu anhu. Hassan radiyallahu anhu was Hassan radiyallahu anhu. Oh, my brother who carries the name Hassan today, revive the legacy of the man after whom you were named. Hassan was the grandson of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Inna bni hadha sayyid. Inna bni hadha sayyid. Wala allallaha an yusliha bihi bayna fi'atayni azimatayni minal muslimin. This youngster, this son of mine, this grandchild of mine is a leader, and surely Allah will make him a means of uniting two factions of this ummah. Hassan radiyallahu anhu goes and purchases the servant and the slave and the orchard and gives it to that individual. That's the reality. That is selflessness. Anyway, نَحْنُ نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ نَبَأَهُمْ بِالْحَقِّ إِنَّهُمْ فِتْيَةٌ آمَنُوا بِرَبِّهِمْ وَزِدْنَاهُمْ هُدَى. I said Allah is focusing and magnifying the aspect fitya. And we were speaking about those four categories. That one is justice is good from everyone, but even greater from the governor and the ruler. And then generosity is wonderful from the wealthy, but nothing better from the poor person, like this person that I just spoke about. And then al-haya'u min al-nisa'i hasan, al-haya'u min al-rijali hasanun, lakin fi al-nisa'i ahsan. Modesty and bashfulness is a beautiful quality, right? He sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that idha fataka al-haya'. If you lose modesty, then fasna' ma shi'at. Fasna' amar bama'na khabar, as the scholars of hadith will tell us. If you've lost modesty, then you are prone to do anything, because guilt, modesty, embarrassment is a natural deterrent which Mother Nature has instilled in us to shield us against wrong. I feel guilty, I feel ashamed, I feel embarrassed. But if you have violated modesty in you, then nothing is to stop you. There's no barriers. So modesty is great if everyone has it. لَكِنْ فِي النِّسَاءِ أَحْسَنِ. But there is nothing better than a modest woman. Modesty in woman just has a different beauty to it. Modesty in men is great. Modesty in woman is just exceptionally different. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the damsels of paradise. فيهن قاصرات الطرف قاصرات الطرف. Allah says their gazes will be lowered. They will be modest in their approach. خيرات حسان, أي خيرات الأخلاق, حسان الوجود. Sublime in their character, stunning in their appearance. And the last out of the four, التوبة من الشيخ حسن لكن في الشاب أحسن. Repentance is wonderful from an elderly man, an old person who has aged, who's weak, who's frail, who's senile, who's close to death by his time and his age. لكن في الشاب أحسن. But a young man in his youth, in his prime, in his adventure, in his curiosity, when everything is happening for him, at that time to give up a life of sin and vice, a life of indulgence and opulence, and to adopt a life of modesty and humility, there's nothing better than that. Yeah. And remember when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam looked at Mus'ab ibn Umair, the young boy who gave up his opulence, and I urge you, my brother, my young man, that youth of yours is an amana from Allah. The least you can do is not use what Allah gave you against Allah. Because when Allah strikes and when Allah snatches, then neither that wealth will remain, nor that fame will remain, nor that health will remain, nor those faculties will remain. The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam looked at Mus'ab ibn Umair. لَقَدْ رَأَيْتُ مُصْعَبًا هَذَا وَمَا بِمَكَّةَ فَتًا أَنْعَمُ عِنْدَ أَبَوَيْهِ مِنْهُ لَقَدْ تَرَكَ ذَلِكَ كُلَّهُ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ وَلِرَسُولِهِ. I remember this Mus'ab. He would walk in Mecca. He would be dressed with the most fine clothing. He would be the most fragrant young man. But today he gave up all that opulence and all that luxury and flamboyance for the pleasure of Allah. And remember, the companions say it was regarding him and his likes that the verse in Surah Al-Ahzab in the 21st chapter, in the 21st juz of the Quran, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ رِجَالٌ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ رِجَالٌ صَدَقُوا مَا عَاهَدُ اللَّهَ عَلَيْهِ. Amongst the believers are those who honored their covenant to Allah. فَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ قَضَى نَحْبَ. Some are those who gave their lives. وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَنْتَظِرْ. And others are in the queue waiting to give their lives. They used to say it is the likes of Mus'ab ibn Umair, to whom the Quran has paid tribute and homage in this lavish praise. إِنَّهُمْ فِتْيَةٌ آمَنُوا. Verse number 13 of the 110 verses. Allah says, إِنَّهُمْ فِتْيَةٌ. They were youth. آمَنُوا. They brought iman on Allah. Now, the last portion of verse number 13 in Surah Al-Kahf, I want to touch on briefly. وَزِدْنَاهُمْ هُدَى. Allah said, we increase them in goodness. So they took the leap and then we amplified it, we increased it, we gave it momentum, we optimized it, we magnified it. The point I'm saying is, you got to take the bold step. وَزِدْنَاهُمْ هُدَى. We will increase. وَيَزِيدُ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ اهْتَدَوْا هُدَى. And Allah says, I continue increasing the guided ones in guidance. قُلْ مَنْ كَانَ فِي الظَّلَالَةِ فَلْيَمْدُدْ لَهُ الرَّحْمَانُ مَدَّى. Say unto them, the one who opts for deviation, then Allah allows them to go deeper in deviation. The person who walked the journey of sin, never thought he'll end up with, or never even planned ending up where he ended up. When he started, speak to a person who unfortunately has the habit of substance abuse, and these analogies come up simply because I deal with it often. Oh, Allah forbid, someone who has a porn addiction. He never assumed his addiction will reach such an evil level. Speak to someone who is unfortunately has a gambling addiction. They talk of compulsive gamblers who wear adult diapers when they playing. Yes, I read an article. Compulsive gamblers wear adult diapers. So while they consumed and playing on the machine, and there is the urge or the need for the call of nature, they would relieve themselves there. This is compulsive gambling. Even at the point you started, you never thought I'll end up there. I'm just taking it recreationally. And you know what? I am one of those addicts who can be productive in life. So I regulate myself. This is not on top of me. That's why I don't need help. But gradually, systematically, the devil takes you deeper and deeper. وَيَمُدُّ عَلَيْكَ حَبْلَهُ. He extends the rope and he draws you in. قُلْ مَنْ كَانَ فِي الضَّلَالَةِ فَلْيَمْدُدْ لَهُ الرَّحْمَنُ مَدَّى. The one who opts for deviation, Allah takes him, leaves him to go deeper. And the famous ayah in Surah Al-Layl, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَأَمَّا مَنْ أَعْطَى وَاتَّقَى وَصَدَّقَ بِالْحُسْنَى فَسَنُيَسِّرُهُ لِلْيُسْرَى. If you bring iman and you do good, we will help you in it. وَأَمَّا مَنْ بَخِلْ. You withhold and you mise. وَاسْتَغْنَى. And you think you're arrogant and self-sufficient. وَكَذَّبَ بِالْحُسْنَى. And you deny the truth. فَسَنُيَسِّرُهُ لِلْعُسْرَى. Then sin will become easy for you, because that's the road. The point I'm saying is, even the pious cannot imagine the feat that they accomplished when they look back. It is only Allah that makes it possible. So what do you have to do, my brother? You have to make the step now. What do you have to do, my sister? You have to take the step now. Delete that wrong from your life now. Shut that haram account. Terminate that engagement totally. Whatever type of interaction of haram. And ask Allah, Allah, I've taken the physical step towards you. You give me the strength. The hadith says about it, and I leave you on this glad tidings. Man atani yamshi ataytuhu harwala. You inch towards me, and I will leap towards you. Wa salli Allahumma wa sallim ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.